coast to coast, you're watching TSN, the sports network. Ahead on TSN Sportsdesk, the Nordiques run into some stiff competition as they put their perfect record on the line. The Beezer tries to sting the Montreal Canadiens for another loss in Florida. Scott Goodyear could be spinning his wheels looking for an Indy ride for next season. The L.A. Raiders shell by the seashore. And the Jazz try to play some traveling music to the tune of an NBA record. So for the big stories and the small, Sportsdesk got it all.
Ankles.
I'll get you back for that before the hour's done. Hi, everybody. Great to welcome to the show. I'm Michael Landsberg.
And I'm Brendan Connor, and we have big news off the top from the NHL, and it comes out of Winnipeg involving one of the premier defensemen in the NHL. Michael?
You know, the St. Louis Blues tried to put together the best team that money could buy. Unfortunately, the one thing that you can't buy is good luck, and the Blues were hammered with a dose of bad luck tonight. In Winnipeg to face the Jets, and looking great so far with Mike Keenan running things, the Blues' chances of having their dream season were seriously hurt tonight. Al McGinnis, the guy's making about $4 million a season, goes down awkwardly. It's a harmless-looking play. It's closely as you take a look at it. It's hard to pick up what happened, but the diagnosis, we have talked to the Jets' publicity department. They are saying McGinnis is gone with a separated shoulder, likely gone for the season. Winnipeg gets on the board first. Eagles breaks down the right side and gets his own rebound, first of the year, but it's a biggie for the Jets, 1-0. Jets then on the power play. Tamu Solani puts it in front to Keith Tkachuk, who bangs it past Jeff Sargent. 2-0 for the Jets on Tkachuk's fifth of the season, and coach Mike Keenan decides it's time for a change. John Casey brought in to replace Sargent, but the change does not help. Thomas Steen walks in front of the net. The backhander past Casey, who was looking pretty awkward on that play, makes it a 2-0 game. Steen second of the year in the third period. Another scary moment. Neil Wilkinson going for the big hit. He misses. The target goes face first into the boards. He was down for a time, but did get up, fortunately, and went to the dressing room on his own steam. We can tell you that now, in the third period, just moments ago, Tamu Solani has scored to give the Winnipeg Jets the go-ahead goal. It is currently 4-3 Winnipeg over St. Louis. Eagles, Tkachuk, and Steen with the other ones. LaPerriere, Shanahan, and Holder for St. Louis. And again, this game very much still in progress. We'll update you on the score at the bottom of the hour.
Okay, let's go on and check out the Quebec Nordiques, one of the two remaining unbeaten teams in the NHL, 5-0. And this man, one of the big reasons why, Stefan Fiset. Halfway through the first period, though, C-Mac finds Corey Millen, and Fiset can only get a piece of that, and that is in behind. Stefan Fiset, 1-0 Devils before the period ends. Owen Nolan with a good chance to tie, but the Calder Trophy winner from last year, Martin Brodeur, gets the stick out, and the puck trickles away harmlessly. Second period, the clubs explode. Look at Randy McKay drill Bob Bassin, and the gate comes open. You hate to see that. And you hate to feel that if you're Bob Bassett. But Quebec answers that. Wendell Clark out of the corner, bangs away at it, and finally slams it in past Brodeur. Wendell's third on the year, and the game is tied at one. And then with the Nords leading 2-1, Alexander C-Mac finds Bill Guerin, who's also off to a good start. A bang-bang play. Guerin's got three on the year, and the game is tied at two. Seesaw battle continues. Bobby Hulick to Stefan Richer. Watch this shot. Top corner, left side. And not much Fiset could do about that. Devils take the lead 3-2. End-to-end action continues. Wendell Clark, initial shot. Look at Joe Sakic diving for the rebound to poke it home as he is being knocked down. It's in, and the game is tied at three. Game tied at four. Less than 4 minutes to play. Once again, Hulick finds Richer. Somebody forgot about him in the slot. He buries it, and the Devils lead 5-4. Now time winding down. Owen Nolan in on Brodeur, but Brodeur stacks those pads and preserves the victory. The Devils hang on to win it. 5-4 at the Meadowlands. First loss for Quebec this year. Alexander C-Mac with two assists. Brodeur stopped 30 shots in this one. There you see the scorers, Millen, Guerin, and McLean. Stefan Richer had a pair. Sakic, Bassin, Clark, and Rosinski for the Nords, who lose their first game of the year.
You like Florida, right? I like Florida. Most Canadians like Florida, but apparently not the Montreal Canadiens. Patrick Waugh and the Canadiens have never won in the Sunshine State. They are in Florida to take on the Panthers. Stu Barnes with the opportunity right there. Barnes rams one home. Barnes, the ex-Winnipeg Jet, off to a great start. And he makes it a 1-0 game. Habs get a break here. John Van Beesbrouck creates the turnover right there. One save by the Beezer, and then another one. Still 1-0 at that point of the game. Second period, Wash shows you his brilliance. Bill Lindsay streaking in. The shot and the save, and watch the save on the rebound. Outstanding by Patrick Waugh. That was a key save. Brilliant goaltending in this game. Then Kirk Muller finally gets the bouncing puck to settle down. Right there, it was kind of a harmless-looking play, but I think the bounce fooled the goaltender as well. 1-1 hockey game. Vincent Domfus then with a great great chance. Listen for the sound here.
There's Dan Foos shooting.
The crossbar. I mean, he had Van Beesbroek beaten cleanly, but he could not beat the goalpost. And then, to add insult to injury, fortunately no injury in the play, Dan Foos at the end of his shift. And I think his face really says it all. It's like, oh, it's with the state of Florida. We can't win there. The Canadiens still winless. Van Beesbroek, 22 saves. Waugh also very sharp. Montreal with Muller. Florida with Barnes. 1-1 when you added up the Canadiens and the Panthers.
Now, the Ottawa Senators and their fans have to believe that with three of the NHL's most highly touted young players, things will eventually improve. I mean, they have to improve because they really have no choice and nowhere to go but up. The Sens looking for their first win of this season, also looking for some production from Bonk and Yashin and Daig as they face the Bruins and their young sensation, a goaltender, Blaine Locker. But at the other end, the not-so-young Donnie Beaupre getting the start for the Senators. Doesn't take long for the Bruins to get to him. Just over a minute in, Steve Leach crosses the line, and the low, hard drive beats Beaupre, 1-0 Bruins. Then, on the power play a little bit later, Cam Neely on the boards. Spots Ray Bourque, low, hard shot again, and a screen in front. And the Bruins have two, and the Sens have 0. 2-0 for the Bruins. The Senators, a frustrated team. Dennis Vial decides to try to spark the team, getting in a big tilt here with Hughes. And that was a heavyweight tilt, I'll tell you. That seemed to help, though. On the power play later, Alexei Yashin spots Alexander Diggs. Side of the net, he puts it past Blaine Locker. Lead cut to 2-1. Ray Bourque, though, having a big night as he will take the feed from behind the net. You got to love when the defensemen sneak in like this. Into the slot he goes. Beaupre hadn't even turned around yet. 3-1 Bruins. Trust Oates to put it on his stick. Young guns, about the only things working for the Sens. Down 4-1, second period. This time, Daig finds Yashin with a nice pass. And it's 4-2 for the Bruins. Boston just too much for the Sens on this night, though. Brent Hughes sends one at the net. Smolinski following up. Holds on. And then beats Beaupre from the impossible angle. Boston up 5-3. They would go on to win by a score of 6-4. The Bruins 13-0 lifetime against the Ottawa Senators. Cam Neely chipping in with a couple of assists as well. On we go to Madison Square Garden now, where a tough night to be an official. More on that in just a moment. And it may be a tough night for Glenn Healy, getting his first start since Christmas 1993. Rangers looking for the quick start. Adam Graves will go to the net. Steve Larmer tees it up and blows it by Darren Puppa. Slow motion. You don't get an appreciation for how hard that was, but good enough to beat Puppa. This one good enough to beat Puppa as well. Kovalev from behind the net trying to center. In off the skate. Ugly, but it counts. 2-0 Rangers. Then the Lightning strike back. Peter Klima in over the line, and he will let the shot go, and you kind of get the view that Glenn Healy has, which is no view. Scores on the screen drive. Tampa Bay down 2-1. Second period, watch the shot off the glass and then off the head of referee Lance Roberts. He leaves the game after getting cut, but he would return wearing a helmet. Smart guy. Rangers leading 3-2 and on the power play, but Mark Bureau intercepts a pass, then works the give and go with Zamner. Bureau on the other end of that pass. He stuffs it in for the shorthanded goal, ties the game at 3. It stays that way into the third. Roman Hamrelick with a great try for the winner, but Glenn Healy with the bubblegum card save right there, and the game ends in a 3-3 tie at MSG. Tampa Bay walking in there and giving a pretty good account of themselves. Healy with 26 saves, Puppa with 25. As you see, Alexei Kovalev with a couple of goals for the Rangers.
I say, but they don't put bubblegum in the cards anymore. Thanks very much. I knew I'd get you back. When you think about it, neither of the Lindros boys has had a smooth entry into the National Hockey League. Eric with his problems with Quebec, Brett signing a huge contract, then having to endure the lockout after getting cut from the Canadian junior team, and still looking for his first NHL goal. Would he get it tonight against his big brother? The answer, definitely no. We can say that because with big brother on the ice, the youngster is up in the press box watching because of a coaching decision, perhaps trying to take some of the pressure off the kid. Brent Fedek finds Joseph Beranek early on, and Beranek slaps it home, 1-0 for Philadelphia. 1:56 to go in the first period. The momentum really changes. Ray Ferraro wins the draw. Scott Lachance with a shot. The screen beats Dominique Roussel. Tied at 1 in just 36 seconds into the second period. Watch the play here by Pierre Turgeon. Great dipsy doodle behind the net. One hand on the stick. He gets it to go. I mean, got the break with a deflection there, but still a pretty play. 2-1 for the Islanders. Flyers tied, but here come the Islanders flatly with a great pass to Lachance. Top shelf. It goes 3-2. After two. Third period, this was a great hockey game. Beranek ties it at 3 for the Flyers, but Ray Ferraro over the line, a snapper beats Roussel. The Islanders back on top 4-3, but here come the Flyers. Beranek gets another chance, picking up the puck from Benoit Hogue. He moves in and scores to send this game into overtime. And in overtime, Hogue with the drop pass to Ferraro. That's Hogue, that's Ferraro, that's the shot, and the deflection. fooling the goaltender. Not much chance. As I said, a great game. Back and forth it went. In the end, it goes to the Islanders. On the road, they defeat the Philadelphia Flyers by a score of 5-4. The lead seemed to change hands about 15 times, although that would be unlikely since there were only 9 goals. Lachance with a pair, his first and second of the year. Turgeon with his fourth. Ferraro had a pair as well. He now has 4. Baranek with 3, including number 4. Brindamore had his second of the year. Ferraro also 2 goals and 2 assists in a good game.
Off to Washington next, Michael, where Jim Schoenfeld's Capitals were facing the Buffalo Sabres on this night. Tight game between these two teams. Some great chances on both sides. Victor Gordiak beats Rick Tabarachi here, but can't beat the post. Goalie's best friend. Some big hits as well. Look at Peter Bondra lay into Peter Svoboda and knocks his helmet right off. That's a big hit. Sabres finally able to solve Tabarachi. Dale Howardchuk gets the bounce up and over Rick Tabarachi right there, and it's in. 1-0 for the Sabres. The Sabres looking to get a little insurance on that later. McGillney gets a breakaway looking for Tabarachi to open up. In alone, McGillney can't do it. Tabarachi stands his ground and moves with him to the backhand. Tabarachi comes up big again, this time on Howardchuk, as he kicks out the pad and gets a toe on it. That is some L-star goaltending right there. Hasek also strong in net for the Sabres. Cap pressing late. Jason Allison to Kalle Johansson there, but Hasek made the save. He gets the shutout as the Sabres 1-0 winners on this night. Dale Howardchuk's fourth of the year. Stands up as the only goal of the game and the winner. Hasek stopping 33 shots for his 9th shutout, and the Caps have scored more than one goal only once and have been shut out twice already. So Buffalo wins 1-0 at Washington. All right, let's go on to the Sharks and the Stars at Reunion Arena in Dallas. Kevin Constantine, the coach of the San Jose Sharks, up against Darcy Wakaluk in net for Dallas on this night. This one rough off the top. Sharks defenseman Andre Nazarov with kind of a cheap shot, maybe a blindsider on Brent Gilchrist. The Stars open the scoring on the power play. Mike Modano, nice feed to rookie Mike Kennedy, who moves in and makes a good move on Artur Zerbe and slips it in as he was being molested a bit by the defenseman there. 1-0 Stars. In the second period, Captain Bob Airey wheels out from the corner with Ulf Dahlin creating some havoc in front of the net. Airey able to score and tie the game at 1-1. Right now we hear that Sandis Ozelnish has scored as well for San Jose in the third period at Reunion Arena, and the Sharks have the go-ahead goal. They lead by a score of 2-1. So with NHL news, it looks as if the Edmonton Oilers' Dean McCammon will be all right, but it doesn't look as if he'll be playing this season. McCammon had his Achilles tendon severed when his leg was stepped on during Wednesday's loss to Chicago. He is expected to be in a cast for about 2 months and won't be able to return to action for 5 months.
Nice to know he'll be okay. Most of us have figured for a long time that Shane Corson was great captain material, so I guess it was real no surprise today when the Oilers made Corson their new captain. Corson's the 8th captain since 1979 in Edmonton. Some rather impressive names have worn the C in Edmonton, including Wayne Gretzky, Mark Messier, and Kevin Lowe. Still to come on TSN Sportsdesk, Art Schell tries to argue the case, but the LA Raiders decide it's time that he moves out of the picture.
And we'll be finding out where Ware will play next year as he prepares to try on the Cats pajamas in the NFL next year. Welcome back to Sports Desk. This news just in, as we love to say. TSN has learned that the CFL commissioner, Larry Smith, is on his way to Columbus, Ohio, home of the Ohio State Buckeyes, to meet with interested parties for a CFL expansion franchise for that city, most likely for the 1996 season. Accompanying Smith are Irv Cross and Tom Matty from the ownership group involved with the Baltimore CFLs. Once again, Larry Smith on his way to Columbus, Ohio, where the Ohio State Buckeyes play, to talk business with business people in that city about a possible CFL expansion franchise for 1996.
Columbus certainly fits the description of the kind of market the CFL has been looking at. Just a couple of weeks ago, Scott Goodyear was ready to re-sign with Walker Racing and team with veteran driver Robbie Gordon. But his ride may have been carjacked today when Walker announced that it had signed Christian Fittipaldi. The 24-year-old is the nephew of Emerson. Christian has driven Formula One for the last 4 years and last season had 7 top 10 finishes. However, there is still hope for Goodyear. Walker is still considering fielding a 3-car team for next season if sponsorship can be secured.
To some NFL news now. If they held surprise parties for firings, I guess Art Schell probably would have known there were people hiding behind the furniture. All week long, the Raiders would neither confirm nor deny that Art Schell was about to be canned, and today there was no denying because it was a confirmation that Schell was fired and Raiders assistant coach Mike White was hired.
I decided that even after 5 years in which 3 of them we were in the playoffs, Art, his first year as full-time head coach, was coach of the year. And the 2 years where we were very close to the playoffs, losing in either the last game or right near the end of the season, would have been a standard that was acceptable throughout the sporting world. Maybe it's because of my age, but we want to win the Super Bowl.
Can you imagine a dream for somebody to have the opportunity to take over a football program that has a history of success, that has tremendous tradition, and even has a logo that is unique? My granddaughter already knows the logo, calls him the Raider Man, and she's under 2 years old. So that's a little bit of an idea of how far-reaching this organization is. They also have a motto, a commitment to excellence. And I think you can tell by Al's remarks, there's a high expectancy here.
By the way, Art Schell had asked the Raiders to remain in his job for another year, but he was turned down. He has already had preliminary discussions about an assistant coaching job with the Miami Dolphins. Stay tuned.
He certainly can't say he didn't get a great chance in Los Angeles. He had lots of opportunity. You win some, you lose some. The San Francisco 49ers won the Super Bowl, but today they lost a second member of their coaching staff. Monday, offensive coordinator Mike Shanahan was scooped up by the Denver Broncos. Today, the Niners' defensive coordinator Ray Rhodes was lured away to become the head coach of the Philadelphia Eagles. Rhodes replaces Rich Kotite, who was fired the day after Christmas, and even though the Eagles talked to a ton of candidates, they say Rhodes was always number one.
Ray Rhodes will be the next head coach of the Philadelphia Eagles. I am as thrilled beyond belief. This was a guy that we've been eyeing for a long time. Unfortunately, we had to wait until after the Super Bowl, but it's worth it to wait for the best.
The Ottawa Roughriders certainly signed a promising player when they got Andre Ware. Only problem was that Ware openly admitted that he had made himself a promise to take another crack at the NFL. And after the Roughriders traded his rights to Sacramento, Ware has made good on his promise and signed with the NFL's expansion Jacksonville Jaguars.
Came in, I threw the ball well, I ran well, so the tools are there. It's just getting there, being given an opportunity to succeed, being placed in an